在场都是很多都是专家啊，所以我讲的尽量短一点，想等大家提问题。
Many of you in the audience are probably quite knowledgeable about the issues, topics on China or U.S.-China, so I'll try and keep my talk short so that you, you have opportunities to ask questions.
主办者的题目是 power, 这个词在中文里有好几个意思。我取其中一个意思，就是说权力，或者说领导者。
The topic of this conference, as I understand, is power. And in the Chinese language, there are many interpretations for this word. And I'll pick one of them to focus on, which is the Chinese meaning of authority.
现在他们正在竞选，为了竞选在吵架，所以我们说的话跟他们没有关系。他们怎么吵都可以，我们跟他们没关系。
指的是美国的竞选哈。So there's a lot of, I understand a lot of debates and arguments in the campaign in the United States, the campaign or the competition for the presidency. My talk here doesn't necessarily relate to any of that.
我只想说呢，我们这个世界在未来的这些年里需要什么样的领导人？
What I want to focus on is what type of leadership the world needs.
我们要知道这个问题呢，首先要知道我们现在处在一个什么样的世界上，这个世界到底是什么样的，我们才知道需要什么样的领导人。
The way I look at this, this question is we first need to understand or grasp what kind of world we live in before we can answer the question what type of leaders would best suit this world.
我们很多的中国人来到美国呢，是拿美国当榜样的，觉得美国是个非常好的国家，又民主又自由，而且很富裕。我们是拿美国当榜样的。同样，现在报纸上、媒体上有很多的美国人说中国怎么怎么好，好的不行了，好像，很多美国人可能也拿中国当榜样呢。但是我看不是这样。
Many Chinese who come to the United States, the purpose of their coming here and in the process of their being here, they view the United States as an example. And right now, I detect a trend.Among the U.S. public, that many people, or some at least, view China in, to some degree or in some aspects as an example too. But I question this. I question whether China ought to be an example for the American public.
很多中国人到了美国，包括我自己，很快地发现美国也有很多的问题。现在看来问题越来越大。那么这些问题是在哪儿来的呢？
Many people, many Chinese, after their arrival in the United States, discover that there are many problems with this society, including myself. And then we start asking this question, what's the origin of these problems? Where do these problems come from?
美国的经济不好，然后经济不好呢，什么原因呢？很多人看到是别人抢走我们的工作了。为什么这些工作会被抢走呢？有很多大企业他们在做这种事，他们为什么能做这种事呢？可能就又是跟政治有关了，跟这个国家的领导阶层有关。
One big issue that's on the minds of many Americans is the question of the state of the economy in this country, and quite a number of people complain that not perfect state of the economy has to do with the outsourcing of jobs. And the fact that these outsourcing of jobs can exist, the export of jobs can exist, has to do with the decision-making process of businesses. And in my opinion, the business leaders or executives, their interests are tied into the American political process as well.
现在越来越多的美国人已经认识到了，就是美国的贫富差距越来越大，什么原因呢？因为大资产的这些大企业，他们和这些政治家勾结在一起，政府的法令、国家的政策都是对这些大企业有利，而对普通老百姓无所谓。
And in my understanding, one problem with the state of economy is that big businesses are now walking hand in hand with the government. And that creates a lot of problem And one of those problems, I mean, it leads to the fact that the inequality or the gap in income is becoming wider and wider.
简单的说，就是美国这个社会，美国的社会逐渐的在背离它原来的形象，民主自由是照顾老百姓的一个社会，现在越来越不是这样了。
So, if we look at it, it looks as if America, right now, the trend is going, is a deviation from its original intent. Its original intent of democracy, freedom, and equality among all. Now we're seeing that it's not really going exactly in that direction.
所以上一次选举的时候，奥巴马的口号就是要改变，所以大家选了他。但是我们看到他上台四年并没有改变什么，如果不是改变得更坏的话。
And Mr. Obama 4 years ago campaigned on the platform of change, and people responded to that. But to me, in the past 4 years, not a lot of change has taken place.
很多的老百姓现在只好出来抗议，比如说华尔街抗议华尔街的那个运动，就是老百姓的一种抗议的声音。
As a result, the American public are quote-unquote taking the streets to protest, I mean, as exemplified by the Occupy Wall Street movement.
但是我在华盛顿这个地方看到的绝大多数的政治家并不认为这种政治需要改变，他们觉得这样挺好，仍然应该继续下去。我想这可能就是美国现在真正的危机。
However, in my dealings with politicians in Washington,I feel not a lot of them, not a lot of the politicians feel the need to change. Rather, they rather enjoy the status quo. And to me, that is the core of the problem.
我们下边说另外一个大国，就是我的祖国中国。
Next, we'll talk about another power, a big country, and that is my home country, China.
那儿情况比美国糟糕得多，到处都是贪官污吏，到处都是穷人。老百姓非常穷，而那些富裕的阶层呢，他们的生活好像比美国还要更加现代化。
And the situation there is much worse than in the situation here in the United States, where poor people are even poorer, a lot poorer than the poor here. And at the same time, the wealthy and the ones with power are doing even better than the wealthy in the United States.
美国的大多数老百姓可能对美国现在状况只是不满意，而中国的大多数老百姓已经是愤怒了，他们已经不是不满意，而是愤怒。
And the state of mentality, if compared with the American public, if we can say that the American public is angry and dissatisfied with the status quo, in China, the public mood is more than angry.
所以在中国，不但是老百姓在谈论要改变，甚至是最高层的那些共产党的领袖们，他们也认为中国需要改变。
What we see now is not only an outcry from the ordinary people wanting change, asking, demanding change in China. We also see this demand rising among the ranks of the Chinese leadership as well.
当然，中国的情况和美国完全不一样。美国的基本制度是好的，我们只要把它改变到回到它仍然是一个老百姓的政权就可以了。
But the difference here is, in the United States, the original intent of this regime, of this government, of the Constitution, how things are set up here, is correct. It's on the right track. Whereas in China, things are different. Not the same can be said.
而中国的情况严重得多。中国的基本的政治体制就是一个不好的制度，连共产党的高层领导人现在也知道那是一个不好的制度。那么怎么样去改变它，怎么让它变得像美国这样有一个基本上好的制度，这是中国的问题。
And how to restructure the political system to make it one that's genuinely beneficial to the public is the challenge that China is facing today.
在美国，你们可以利用现在的这个比较好的民主制度去约束你们的领导人，看住你们的领导人，或者去支持你们的领导人。但在中国正好相反，中国需要的是革命，需要改变整个的政治体制。
If what is needed in America today is steps or measures to improve the system, what is needed in China today is not an improvement upon the existing system, but a total revolution, a change.
我走遍了世界，看了很多的国家，包括跟很多的政治家都是朋友，甚至可以说一些私房话，所以我得出一个结论，全世界的政治家都差不多，都不怎么样。
On the topic of the quality of political persons, figures or politicians, I've traveled many places in the world, and I've gotten a conclusion that most of them, if not all of them, are crooks.
So,
regardless of which country they live in.
就好像你们家雇了一个佣人，这个佣人总是想偷你家东西，所以你的责任就是要看住他。
It's like, if I may use this metaphor, it's like you hired a bad servant, and his intent is always to rob you of your things, of your possessions, of your rights. And so what you need to do is to really safeguard him.
在美国，你们有这个制度，你们有这个体制，关键是你们自己，美国的老百姓没有把你们的政治家看好，让他们能够骗你们。
And not to safeguard, but to check.On this servant. But in the United States, you have a system of checks and balances, but in China, we can't.
但在中国的问题是你根本看不住这个人，这个仆人他可以随便偷你家的东西，甚至他来欺负你，把老百姓不当人一样的。在中国，所以情况跟美国是完全不一样。中国是要彻底改变这种不好的社会制度。
And in China, we have no measures in place to check.Or balance on this servant who's not serving the interest of the master, I mean the public. So we need a systemic change.
所以在中国需要的是革命，需要把这个政权推翻，然后建立新的制度。不光在中国，在很多的所谓的第三世界的国家都有类似的问题。
So what we need in China is an overthrow of the current regime and start anew.And this, to me, is not what China needs. It's what a lot of developing countries need today.
另外有很多国家跟你们美国情况一样，只需要你们老百姓把这些政治家看住就行了。那比如说欧洲那些国家，可能比美国情况更糟糕一些。
And some countries don't need such a revolution, like countries in Europe. They may need improvement upon the existing system, like the United States.
我听说在法国，一个部长就可以每天中午花政府几千欧元去吃一顿很丰盛的午餐，包括他的助手们。
He's heard that in France, some ministers spend several thousand euros lunching with himself and his staff. That doesn't sound right.
所以那边的很多情况可能比美国更糟糕，但是呢，他们也跟美国一样有一个基本好的制度。那么。现在需要老百姓自己动作起来，把你们的政府官员给看住了。
So in that sense, the situation in certain European countries is even worse than the United States. I mean, the corruption issue. But what they need there is, as I said before, is some sort of reform or improvement upon the existing system.
但是中国和另外的很多的穷国，他们占世界人口的大多数，在这些国家可能需要的是革命。
But in China and some other developing countries, what they need is a revolution.
那么未来的领导人应该是什么样的领导人呢？在中国或者那些穷的国家，可能需要出来一些能够打破常规的、能够不考虑自己和家属的利益的这样的政治家出来彻底的改变它，否则就是老百姓把它推翻。
So the next question is, what type of leaders do we need in China and other developing countries? To me, we need leaders who are willing to sacrifice their own interests on behalf of the public. Otherwise, if it's a leader who cannot sacrifice and identify himself and his interest with the public's interest, the public will sooner or later overthrow him.
但是在那些地方，在这些穷的国家，在中国这样的穷的国家里头，发生革命，不管是和平的革命还是暴力的革命，不可能和美国没有关系。
But whatever happens or is going to happen in China and other developing countries will have something to do. It's linked with what's going on in the United States.
所以，在美国的领导人也需要和现在不一样的，就是需要有魄力的。 不但能够改变现在美国的政治的困境，而且还要应对全世界发生的各种各样的革命。
So the next question is, what type of leadership do we need, would we like to see in the United States? I can tell you, it's not the current type of leadership and leaders we're seeing. We'd like to see leaders with vision.
过去的几十年可能是比较安静的几十年，大家日子过得很好，大多数的美国人，我接触的很多人都是，他们不太关心政治，管他谁当总统呢，无所谓。但是我觉得今后的几十年可能不能这样了。
I think in the past several decades, the American public is rather content, is more or less content with what's been going on in this country. But to me, in the next few decades, I don't think the public will remain as content.
面对一个令大家不满意的世界，一个可能会很快变化的世界，那么需要的领导人呢，可能不是过去那样四平八稳的领导人。他应该是比较有魄力的，有思想的，而且愿意为了使这个国家变得更好呢，愿意做出牺牲的这种人。
So what we will need in the future is leaders with vision and with a certain decisiveness, and who are able to lead and not just to cater to public demands.
除了要有这些有思想、有牺牲精神以外，我觉得很重要的一点就是他必须获得你们广大人民的支持，无论在美国还是在中国都是一样的。
And this leader, he said earlier, will be able to, will be willing to sacrifice with, for the public and will need the support from the broad public.
在美国当然要通过选举，这些政治家都很会讨好老百姓，他们也会说很多假话，所以老百姓也要辨别你所支持的领导领袖人物，他是不是一个说真话的人？这点非常重要。
There's a lot of campaigning going on in America, and I think a challenge for the public is to be able to distinguish what the candidate says and what he actually means.
我看到在美国和欧洲呢，最近这一二十年以来，我观察的状况就是，好像政治家们越来越习惯于竞选的时候什么都可以说，上台以后什么都可以不做。
What I've observed is a trend where politicians feel free to make any promise they feel like, and but as soon as they get into the office, those promises are gone with the wind.
我觉得这个责任不完全是这些政治家。凡是政治家肯定他都要说假话的，这好像是个通用的规律，关键是老百姓允不允许他说假话。我觉得西方老百姓太容忍这些政治家撒谎了，所以这些政治家撒谎就成了习惯。
I think that politicians are habitual, what you say, you know, liars or empty promise makers. We can't totally blame this symptom or this trend on the politicians alone. Rather, I think the general public has been too tolerant of the fact that leaders or candidates once in office do not keep their promises. Therefore, the public is a stakeholder in this too.
所以我刚才说过，你们美国人最重要的事情就是要看住你们的政治家，像看住你们自己的钱包一样。
So, as I said earlier, the public has the responsibility to carry out the task of checking and balancing the politicians, making sure they don't rob from your pocketbooks and making sure that they are there to serve your best interest.
你们美国人有很好的制度，你们完全可以做到这一点。你们手里都握有自己的选票，而且可以自由地发表意见。之所以你们的政治家变得越来越糟糕，我觉得这是你们自己太懒了。
So, what's not going right in America today? It's not just the responsibility or the fault of the politicians alone. I think it has to do with the fact that the American public has gotten lazy, has not fully exercised their democratic rights.
要知道那些政治家离你们并不远，他们是什么样的人可能关系到大家的钱包问题。
I mean, the politicians, they are very close to you in the sense that whatever they decide, the policies they make directly affect you, your livelihood, your pocketbook.
在中国呢，老百姓现在也越来越认识到这一点了。过去呢，很多中国人受到共产党的教育，认为国家大事都是那些领导人们管的，老百姓不要去干预它。但是现在老百姓渐渐也明白了，我们日子过得不好，就是因为这些领导人太糟糕了。
Mm-hmm. And in China, people used to think that politics is and the political decision-making process is far, far away from the ordinary people. But increasingly, they're realizing that what folks in Beijing decide, what the leadership decides, has a lot to do with their daily lives and their livelihood.
所以在中国，我们大家所有的中国人现在都想一个问题，就是怎么样建立一个像美国这样的制度，让我们老百姓有权利去把那些政治家看起来。
So what's on the mind of every Chinese is how to establish a system like the system in the United States so that ordinary people can check and balance the decision makers in the leadership.
所以我们现在主要工作是向你们学习，但是在学习的同时我们也会看到你们一些问题。
So mostly I think what we need to learn from you, the American public, and the American system by and large, but at the same time, we are seeing problems too, and we're not blind to them.
一看到这么多年轻人，我就讲的时间长了点啊，现在留几分钟给大家提问题。
Now, feel free to ask some questions.
A couple of the earlier speakers talked about the importance of narratives and stories. And they talked about the American stories. The ones we learn are that there's the American dream, you work hard, you succeed. And some people learn that in America we are blessed by God, we're special compared to everyone else.
他说在美国哈。啊，好多人就是有一些人认为，就是说美国呢是一个有一个美国梦的地方，只要你努力勤奋哈，就能实现这个美国梦。但是同时呢，在美国有另外一些人觉得哈，美国是一块特殊的土地，就是说上帝特别惠顾的这么一个地方。
I'm curious what the Chinese think we believe, and I also would be curious what the Chinese story is, what the Chinese dream is.Because here in the U.S., we've heard two versions of the Chinese story. One is that China for thousands of years was the dominant power, and they felt they were better than everyone. The other story we've heard is that in the 1800s and the 1900s, the British, the Japanese, everyone invaded China, so the Chinese feel very defensive. What's the real Chinese story?And what's the story that you think we believe about ourselves?
它有两个问题，一个呢就是说哈，中国人是怎么看待哈美国人自己看自己的，是吧哈？他们自己眼中的美国这样。第二个问题可能是更重要的哈，就是说中国人是怎么看待自己的历史文化和现在？因为他说美国人的眼里呢，哈，中国人有两个，就是说对自己的一个过去的看法。一个是呢，我们有5000年的文化，多么优秀，多么辉煌，比其他各民族都更发达一度。还有另外的一方面的说法呢，就是说，哎呦，我们受到列强的侵略呀，怎么样啊，怎么不行了？他说中国人是怎么看待自己的国家的这种历史传统啊？怎么讲的？自己的叙述，自己的过去。
首先得讲啊，中国人也是。13亿个人可能有13亿个看法，不完全一样。我把大家的看法总结一下，给你一个简单的回答。
First of all, there are 1.3 or 4 billion Chinese. So there may be as many as 1.3 or 4 billion opinions. I cannot speak on behalf of all those opinions, but I'll try and summarize mostly what they think.
很多中国人从电影里、电视里看到一些故事，过去古代的故事，觉得美国人确实很好。很多人移民到这儿来以后，通过自己的努力。然后过上小康的生活，过得很好，甚至发了财。那么他们认为，所谓的在中国人心目中的美国梦，就是我们可以靠自己的努力去发财。
Mm-hmm. A lot of people watched movies and this and that and learned about the narrative of the American dream. And to them, the American dream is something like you said. You work hard and you strive and you achieve what you desire. That's what's...
当然这个标准不完全一样啊。农村的人可能觉得我有一块地自己耕种，然后没有人来苛捐杂税就很好了。但是城市里人觉得，我可能应该成为百万富翁，标准是不一样的。但是总之，他们觉得美国是一个自由的地方，我们可以通过自己努力发财。
嗯哼 ，the different levels of achievement and prosperity for the more rural population is perhaps to have some of your own land and.Have your own achievement, but some urban population, they might think I ought to be a billionaire at least. But by and large, people in China think there is freedom in this country to do what you want to do. I mean, sky's the limit to try and achieve your dreams.
中国人怎么看自己呢？我觉得过去一百多年的历史对中国人的心理影响还是很大的。
And now, how do the Chinese view themselves, and what's their narrative? To me, the history of the past 100 years does have a significant imprint on the Chinese psyche.
在过去的两千年里，中国的地位可能比现在美国的地位还要高。世界各国的人都跑到那儿去定居，都想在那儿留下来，想法搞一份绿卡，然后搞一个美国公民，觉得很高兴了。因为那个时候，中国是比较自由的，比较富裕的。但是在最近的一两百年里，中国已经落后了，那么而且受到很多国家的欺负。
During certain periods in China's history over the last 2,000 years, China was probably more at times more prosperous than any other nation on the earth. I mean, in those times, China attracted immigrants from foreign lands.You know, who wanted to get a green card in China and settle down there because the system then was better than what they had at home. However, in the last 200 years, China has fallen behind.
一百多年前的中国人呢，有点像现在的美国人。谁跟我闹意见，谁跟我搞得不高兴了，我可以揍他，我可以把他打败。但是他们打了一下，他们自己打败了，中国人打败了。开始他们很惊奇，觉得不对，后来就产生了一个很严重的民族自卑感，就觉得我们的什么都不好，我们的文化也不好，我们的人种也不好，我们的什么都不好，产生这个很严重的民族自卑感。大概一百年前发生的那个五四运动，可能就是这种自卑心理的最直接的表达。
More than 100 years ago, China was at a stage where it felt like perhaps how America.Feels today, which is whoever we don't find behaving in the way we want, we can go out and launch a military attack on them and expect to win. However, what happened in those campaigns is that China lost, and this to the Chinese came as a shock. And as a result of this shock and the defeat,the certain feelings of inferiority developed.
这种自卑心理呢，笼罩着整个东亚，不光是中国，笼罩很多国家这个老百姓的心理，产生了一些东西。比如你看现在 Chinatown 有很多年轻人，他们把他们头发染成黄的，你明明是黑头发，你干嘛要染成黄的呢？
So this these feelings of inferiority have led has affected and observably among Asian nations as a whole, not just China, and even it extends to even today, as we can see from certain young people living in New York's Chinatown, dyeing their hair blonde or something. To me, it's all a reflection of this sort of this psyche.
这种很强烈的自卑心理呢，渗入到中国人生活中的每一部分，而且在压制着整个十三亿中国人的那个思想，压制着他们的那个信心。
These feelings have become a force of oppression in the national mentality among the Chinese.
和其他地方的情况一样，这种自卑心理的另一面呢，就是这种排外心理。 动不动就爱国主义发起来了，然后砸车、烧商店等等。
And the other side of this coin is expressions of nationalistic feelings. I mean, actions that accompany those feelings. You know, burning foreign cars or strong anti-foreigners sentiment.
所以你看，整个中国的社会情绪有点像那个被欺负了的那个少年，经常受欺负的少年人一样。他要么就是对别人很不信任。然后排斥别人，要么就觉得自己像条狗一样，必须依附于什么人，总是在这两种不正常的情绪之间跳来跳去，这可能是中国现在的很大的问题。
What I see is the a dichotomy of it's not unlike a kid that's bullied in his younger years. On the one hand, he may become very distrustful of others.And on the other hand, 我忘了你说他一方面受气，另一方面不信任。
一方面就是他不信任别人，另一方面就是就有很强的排斥，要么就另一方面就像狗一样，总觉得自己要依附于什么人。
So he may be resentful of others and distrustful of others, or he may be very submissive to others.
也就是总是在奴隶和暴民之间跳来跳去，总是回不到一个正常的状况。
And alternating between a slave mentality and the mentality of 这个暴民 a mob, I guess, violent mobs.
很遗憾啊，时间到了。
Yeah, so okay, we'll have to stop here. Thank you very much.
谢谢大家。